Good morning, Living Word family. We are so glad that you've joined us this morning. Thank you for taking the time to be with us. We're here, we're going to just sing a couple songs, but we're here to declare that He is good. I want you to just take a moment, if you will, and just think about the goodness of God. He's been so good to you. He's been so good to me. If we still have breath today, that is a good thing. Amen. So why don't you praise Him with us? And in our praise comes our breakthrough. So let us just spend a few moments this morning worshiping the Lord, because He alone is good.
Lord, I thank you. My heart is full. My heart is full. My heart could I forget what you've done for me? You are faithful. Never fail me yet, never fail me yet. You are good to me. I am grateful, grateful. How could I forget, how could I forget what you've done for me? You are faithful. Never fail me yet, never fail me yet. You are good to me. I'm grateful, grateful. How could I forget, how could I forget what you've done for me? You are faithful. Never fail me yet, never fail me yet. You are good to me. And I'm grateful, grateful. How could I forget, how could I forget what you've done for me? And I'm faithful. Never fail me yet, never fail me yet. You are good.
Thank you, Jesus. We're so grateful, God, for everything that you've done. Thank you, God. Hallelujah. We give you the praise. We give you the honor. We give you the glory, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
God of mercy, please come rescue me. I am longing for your voice, gentle whisper in the noise. Father, tell me everything's all
Jesus, forever by my side. Father, we ask that you would use our gifts to open up the heavens and create breakthrough both in our church and all over the world. Thank you for receiving our gifts as we give cheerfully. Living Root family, your gifts help us maintain our day-to-day church operations, and because we are a missions-focused church, your gifts also help us minister to others locally and support our missionaries abroad. You can also give safely and securely on our website at lwicc.org or Living Word Church app, or text LWGIVE and the dollar amount to 74483. And of course, you can also mail your checks to the church, payable to LWICC. And let's now lift these gifts up before the Lord. Father, thank you for providing us with what we need exactly when we need it, in the amount we need it. And thank you for giving us your peace that passes all understanding. And thank you for giving us not only provisions physically, emotionally, but you also give us spiritually, God. Lord, we need you, and I pray that you'll provide us with your wisdom as Dr. Nana comes up on stage to deliver your word, and help us to be full of wisdom and full of knowledge. In Jesus' name, I pray, amen. And now, let's prepare our hearts and minds to hear from Dr. Nana Ceasar.
Good morning, church. It is great to be back. I've missed all of you guys, and I know the Lord is keeping you. We are going to be going right into God's word. Let's turn to prayer. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, we are praying that today you will transfer the substance of your word, your substance, into our hearts. Your word says that we communicate spiritual truths with spiritual language. And Holy Ghost, I am praying that in this time you deposit treasure in every heart that is hearing. And lives will be changed, and this church will be changed and blessed. We thank you for your goodness. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So, we are going right into God's word. And this morning, I am starting a mini-series on church according to Jesus. Church according to Jesus. You guys know how we have the gospel according to Mark, or the gospel according to Luke. Essentially, what it means is that this is a story of the gospel according to the way Mark saw it, or Luke saw it, or Matthew saw it. So when I say church according to Jesus, and it may sound like something that is redundant, but you'll understand as we go. And when I say church according to Jesus, essentially what I'm saying is that we are going to be studying the way Jesus defines church. The way Jesus defines church. And that is really important because you want to do things according to what Jesus said. First of all, the church belongs to Jesus. You know, sometimes pastors and men of God get carried away and they say, my church, my people. Not one pastor died for you. There is not one prophet, one apostle that died for you. The person who died for you is Jesus. And before you start saying, yeah, preach it to the pastors, I want to flip it to church members. Church members love to idolize pastors. You love to idolize apostles. It's in man. We like to do that. But it's very important to understand that Jesus is called the great shepherd of the sheep. The person who owns the church, the universal church and this local church, is not one person. It's not a pastor, it's not an apostle, it's not a prophet, it is Jesus Christ. So, it is so important that we understand what Jesus thinks is church. We understand that. It is so important that we understand that. When we were kids in high school, there was a joke. There was a joke that a guy had studied about the forest. He had studied about the forest in preparation for his exam. And he sat in the exam and he saw that the question was about birds and not the forest. The question said, write about birds. And the joke was that this guy was so desperate, he started the first sentence. He said, birds fly in the forest. So at this point, one may ask, what is a forest? And then he took off. And the whole three-page essay was about the forest because that is what he knew. And we used to joke about it because we used to call it deviation. We used to laugh at people and say, you've deviated, man. That is, you had just forest in your head. So you forced it into this question about birds. And you may say, where is he going with this? The reason I bring this up is Many times we deviate when it comes to church. Because we are human and we are fleshly, and your default is the flesh. Until you come to Christ, your default is the flesh. We start off saying Jesus is Lord. He's the way, the truth, the life. And then we flip it and say, at this point, one may ask, what is church about? And then we define it according to our parameters. So this sermon is not about church according to you. We are not asking your opinion about church. We are not taking a poll about church because you did not die for the church. You did not birth the church. I did not. I dare not bring my opinions here. I dare not deviate and insert my thoughts, my ideas, and the ideas of big names. It is important that as a pastor, I make sure that I have figured out what church according to Jesus is. And as we go into God's word, we may find some things that are uncomfortable. But you know, Jesus said that through the traditions of men, we make the word of God of none effect. That is an interesting statement. I thought the word of God was all powerful. But Jesus said the Pharisees were able to use their traditions to neutralize and nullify God's word. Tradition is powerful. The system is powerful. If you don't believe it, ask Martin Luther, who nailed his thesis to the door and was running for his life because the system was after him. But Jesus didn't die for a system. He died for people. He died for you. He died for me. There is a scripture, and let us flip to it in 1 Peter 2, 1 to 5. Let's flip to 1 Peter 2, 1 to 5. So 1 Peter 2, 1 to 5 says, let me just get this up. 1 Peter 2, 1 to 5 says this. Therefore, putting aside malice and guile or tricks and hypocrisies and envies and all evil speaking, as newborn babes, long for, desire the pure milk of God's word, that you may grow. If so be you have tasted that the Lord is gracious, to whom you've come as unto a living stone, rejected indeed of men, but chosen of God and precious. And verse 5 is my punch verse. It says, you also are living stones. You are built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. You also are living stones. You are built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. So the first thing we are learning about the church is that according to Jesus Christ, the church is not a building. And you may say, oh, yeah. We know. Church is not a building. But it is important we slow down and think about this. The Bible says the church is a spiritual building that is put together by living stones. So the priority of the church is not to paint a building. The priority of the church is not to get more seats. They are important. Those aid, and let me use the word abet, the actual purpose of the church. But the priority of the church is to deal with living stones. If property, money, buildings were indispensable to the function of the church, then in places like China, there would be no church. So the priority of the church is to build up living stones. And the Bible says that they are built up as a spiritual house. In this beautiful building, the stones sit next to each other. They fit, and by that means a structure goes up. And in our dealing, we need to make sure that that priority is maintained. The priority is living stones. And if you are listening to me, I'm asking you to say, put your hand on your chest and say that I am a living stone. Jesus did not die for property. He did not die for money. He did not die for titles. He died for living stones. And the reason I'm slowing down to say that is something happens when a church runs for a while. Initially, some things were supposed to aid and abet. They were supposed to help. But with time, because again, we are fleshly humans, with time, if you are not careful, the flesh will help you to exalt those assist devices. The flesh will help you to start exalting those things, and slowly they become the priority. If in planning for church, if in talking about church, we are talking mostly about property, about a building, about chairs, which are all very important. But if we are mostly talking about that, we need to be careful. We need to elevate whatever it takes to make sure that living stones grow in the Lord. I hope you are following me. The Lord is calling us to reorder our priorities. The church is set up with living stones. So just keep that in mind. As we go along, I'm going to be throwing out a couple of parables. And some may be true stories, some may be not. But I read this thing in a book. They said a guy set out to open a stall or a storefront. And his purpose was that he wanted to get people healthy. So he opened Dimitri's Healthy Meals. Put up a big sign. Dimitri's Healthy Meals. So everybody knew that this thing was to make people healthy. There was just a little problem. As he started selling these healthy meals, he noted that people did not like them. So he added just a little bit of sugar to get the healthy stuff going. Just a little bit of whipped cream and sugar. With time, he noted that people were enjoying the whipped cream and sugar. So the whipped cream and sugar took over the healthy meal. So initially, the whipped cream and sugar was just 1%. Oh, I'm just doing it so that it tastes nice for them. But he noticed that, hey, that is working. That is working. More people were coming in. So the percentage moved from 1% to 10% to 20%. And the time came that when you walked into Dimitri's Healthy Meals, it was all sugar and whipped cream. Apologies to all those who love sugar and whipped cream. I'm not making a political statement, but in general, I'm just using this as an example. It was 100% sugar. Actually, let's just say it was 95% sugar and whipped cream. And the healthy meal was now 5%. And we asked the guy, and I'm calling him Dimitri today. We asked the guy, we said, I thought you wanted to sell healthy meals. He said, yeah, but you know, it's working. The sugar is working. The whipped cream is working. And we asked him, what do you mean working? Well, tons of people love it. And then we went back and said, I thought you started off saying this was for healthy meals, healthy. Tons of people love it, but are they healthy? That was your original intent. Said, oh, it doesn't really matter. Now it's booming. People love it. And people are mentioning my name everywhere. And he went right on. And Dimitri's Healthy Meal still has the sign there, but it is full of unhealthy stuff. This is a parable of how a church can morph because of pressures of life. So that what was 1% just to help things along now becomes 95%. And church, according to Jesus, starts with that. For us to remember the original intent of Jesus Christ as he died on that cross and as he rose, it was to release living stones. Organizational principles are important in a church, but please remember the church is not an organization. The church is not an organization, and I'm willing to go toe-to-toe with anybody who would challenge me on that. The church is not an organization. Jesus did not give birth to an organization. Organizational principles are important. They help, but the church is not an organization. The church is an organism. The church is an organism. In an organism, there is some organization, but organization doesn't take over. It is life that runs in an organism. It is relationships and interactions that run in an organism. I'm going to give you one more story. This is a true story. There was a time I was hanging out with some pastors, and they were good friends of mine. And one day, I met with them as usual, and all of them, or most of them, were all stressed. They would not smile. They would not talk to me. And I was wondering, what happened? These guys are my friends. And they were busy in a big project in a city, working in the city. And then later on, I realized that they were going to meet their senior pastor. And because of how he treated them and what he did to them, they were so scared and stressed that they could not even smile with me. And he was pushing the mission to be accomplished in the inner city. But the problem was that in accomplishing the mission, all the pastors who were helping him along were miserable. They were miserable, they were scared, they did not do it with joy, they did it out of compulsion because of the relationship among them. I'm quoting from a pastor I heard in Uganda. He said, "We cannot do God's work the devil's way." In being mission and vision driven, we want more people, we need to do this. In doing that, we still need to walk in the fruit of the Spirit. In doing that, we still need to slow down and love. If the people who are accomplishing the mission are traumatized in doing it, we have failed. Because church, according to Jesus, is based on living stones. So just keep that in mind. Church, according to Jesus, is based on living stones. I'm going to read some scriptures. Let us read from Amos chapter 5, verse 21, downwards, probably till 27. He says, "I hate, I despise your feast days. I will not smell in your solemn assemblies," or my Bible's note said, "appreciate your solemn assemblies. Though you offer me burnt offerings and your meat offerings, I will not accept them, neither will I regard the peace offerings of your fat beasts. Take away from me the noise of your songs, for I will not hear the melody of your viols. But let judgment run down as waters, and righteousness as a mighty stream." Verse 25, "Have you offered to me sacrifices and offerings in the wilderness for 40 years, O house of Israel? You have borne the tabernacle of your Moloch and Chion, your images, the star of your God, which you made to yourselves. And therefore, you will go into captivity." I think we can end here. Now, why do I read this verse? Let us start from verse 21. The Bible says God was telling Israel that he hated something. Now, in American slang, hate is a common word. People say, "I hate that, I hate that." But if you slow down and you find out what hate really means, it is a revulsion. It is something that he can't stand. So we would like to know what the Lord cannot stand. And here he said, "I cannot stand it when you have your feast days and your solemn assemblies and burnt offerings and meat offerings and songs." But I'm taken aback when I read this, because I'm turning to the Lord and say, "Lord, the feast day came from you. You told Israel to have a feast day. You told them to to have a solemn assembly, to offer meat offerings and drink offerings and sing. All those things came from the Lord. That was, let me use the word, the summary, the essence of their worship. Let's flip to the New Testament. In our church today, what is the summary of our worship? We pray. We fast. We sing praise and worship songs. We give. And there are a lot of other things that we do. And they came from the Lord, like these feast days. Like these burnt offerings, they all came from the Lord. But the time comes that people can be praying and God hates it. The time comes that people can be singing a so-called powerful worship song. The songs were great and God is saying, this is noisy. It's like nails on a chalkboard to me. A time comes, somebody plays a lovely tune on the keyboard. We are admiring his skill, saying, this is wonderful. And God is saying, I hate it. Because it happened in the Old Testament. And if you do not believe me, we are going to go into the New Testament and look at it happening. A time comes that all our acts of worship do not count before God, and we are Christians. I'm not saying you are not a Christian. I'm not talking to unbelievers here. I'm talking to children of God who have perfected churchianity and serving God. They know how to pray. They know how to fast. They know how to worship. They know how to dance and give. But a time comes that God says, I hate it. I can't take it anymore. And when does this happen? Because people's hearts are not right. Relationships are not right. Love is not walked in. And people have forgotten that we are living stones. So look at verse 24. He says, let judgment run down as waters. Of course, for those of you following the civil rights movement, you know Martin Luther King used to quote this verse a lot. But he picked it from here, but my whole point is that the Lord is more interested in judgment and righteousness than in feasts, than in songs, than in sacrifices and offerings. And you remember the scripture in 1 Samuel where it said, to obey is better than sacrifice. In the kingdom, we have sacrifices we give, but there comes a time when God can turn off his attention from our sacrifices, because we need to have right hearts. The priority of every church is to make sure that hearts are right. Otherwise, all our spiritual acrobatics, standing on our head, fasting, praying, all of that do not count before him. And I don't know about you, but when I fast, it's rough. Left to me, I would never fast. I don't know about you. There are times when you pray and it's not easy. You are praying through. I would hate for all the things I'm doing to not count before God. I would hate that. I want to make sure that what I do, the songs I sing to the Lord, the prayer I pray, the Lord is not saying, take it away from me. I can't stand it. And like I said, we are going to look in the new covenant, but I want to introduce that concept to you, that not everything that looks Christian is accepted of God. Please, I need us to remind ourselves of that and make sure that the whole purpose of church, the priority is to make sure that our offering as a church in prayer, in all those things, in giving, is acceptable before the Lord. It is according to Jesus. And we are going to be going into further scriptures in our second part. But I want you to just think about that. That could God hate something that looks so spiritual? Oh, yes, he could. So we are going to study that in our second part. But we want to go into prayer. That Lord, open my eyes and let me know what counts before you. Open my eyes and let me know what counts before you. Someone has said that thanksgiving, you can say thank you to somebody. But what about if you say thank you to somebody, you say 10 thank yous, and right after that, you go and insult their son. The thank you is canceled. So thanksgiving with our mouth, for instance, is great. when we give it to God. But hey, what about the rest of our lives? Is our life shouting thanksgiving? And that is just one part. So we want to pray. We want to pray for the genuine. We want to pray for the real deal. Why don't you pray for a second? You do not want anything you're doing in the kingdom to be a waste. You want to make sure that it counts before God. Let us pray. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, we are praying that you breathe on your word and work in our hearts and open our eyes and let your light shine and let us live in a church according to you, Lord Jesus, not according to our plans, not according to our thoughts, not according to what we think is right. And let your glory be seen and let your name be lifted up. We thank you for your goodness, O Lord. In the matchless name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. God bless you. We are going to continue this, the second part, in the next couple of weeks. And may God continue to reveal himself to you and place his hand upon you. Have a blessed day.
Good morning, Living Word family. I am one of Living Word's Sunday champions. But you can call me Champ. Anyway, joining us for Pentecost next Sunday is Bishop Robert Stearns. We welcome his return back to Living Word. Bishop Stearns is the founder and executive director of Eagle's Wings, a global Jerusalem-centered movement focused on the dignity of all peoples. Invite your friends and family. Last year's service was very impactful, and you won't want to miss out on this one. Last week, Lulu told us what a Sunday champion is. And I think it's you. Honor the Lord with your brothers and sisters with your giftings or skills at Living Word. Where is the Lord calling you? Are you good with people or do you prefer to be behind the scenes? If you like media, we have a place just for you. Become a Sunday champion by registering on our website or social media. Our drive-through food bank drop-off is next Sunday, May 23rd. Bring your non-perishable food items to the church from 3 to 4 p.m. Share Christ's love with our neighbors in need, and remember to keep donations in their original packaging and check the freshness dates. Your white basket offering today will support our local outreach, which is ministering to people right here in our community. Your children's fund offering will send kids straight to Camp Sunshine. Donate to the Camp Sunshine Scholarship Fund for summer 2021. If you have any needs or prayer requests, just let us know. Why? Because we love you. Call 301-989-HOPE extension 1600 or email care@lwicc.org. Also, you can stay in touch with us through our social media, Living Word app, YouTube, and our website. And remember, this is living.
Thank you for joining us for this week's message. We hope that you heard something that will make a difference in your life. If you're part of the Living Word family and wish to give in support of this ministry, visit us online at www.lwicc.org and click on the tab that says Give. You may also give through our Living Word Church app, or you can text LW Give and the dollar amount to 74483. Next week's White Basket offering goes to Eagle's Wings. For more information about Living Word International, service times, directions, and how to sow into the ministry, visit us online at www.lwicc.org. Again, that's lwicc.org. Thank you again for visiting us and have a blessed week.